Good morning, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you all to the second edition of the Orange City Literature Fest, organized by SJR Knowledge Foundation. I'm Samath Khurana, your anchor for this session. The session is of 40 minutes. The topic for the session is writing historical fiction, telling our history through stories. I'm very pleased to announce the speaker of this session, Ma'am Gopia Basu. Ma'am has worked as a journalist with the Times of India, the Economic Times, the Indian Express, and Business Today. She has written on a variety of topics, including business, education, art and culture, and travel. Her debut book, Khoka, was published in 2015. Her books, The Queen's Last Salute and Anarkali, are the bestsellers of this segment. Ma'am believes that the objective of a historical fiction writer should be to bring to life certain aspects of history and not to change it. We should focus on the present and hence enhance what's there and pull it out from the layers of obscurity. We welcome you, ma'am. Now, I shall also introduce Ma'am Sonali Lakshin as the moderator for this session. Ma'am is the master program head at 97.7 Big FM. Working in media from the past 12 years, started her career as an RJ with Red FM as a morning show host with the name RJ Ria. Bijli Bhai Mahatir Mala was an award-winning sparkler which received Maharashtra Samaj Ratna Puraskar. Times Group published a front page series on consecutive 7 days when she was doing as the response editor in the Times of India. Ma'am also hosted an international show on Body 102.9 FM for Washington, D.C., Virginia, and Boston. She has also interviewed more than 2,500 celebrities, including APJ Abdul Kalam and Pratibhatai Patil. More than 1,000 articles published in Loknath, Dainik Bhaskar, Kolkata, and Times Group. It is an honor to welcome you both. Now over to you, Sonali ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so very much. वैसे ये बात कहना चाहूंगी, history geography इतनी बेवफा, रात को पढ़ो तो सुबह सफा, ऐसे कुछ कहा जाता था हम लोग जब पढ़ाई करते थे. लेकिन अगर हिस्ट्री इतनी इंटरेस्टिंग हो और ब्यूटीफुल बन जाए, जहाँ पर स्टोरीज हो और सुनने के लिए कहानियां ही कहानियां हो, तो मुझे लगता है ये कहानियां बहुत ज्यादा देर तक हमारे जहन में रहती भी है और हम इसे बहुत शौक से पढ़ते भी हैं. वेल, आज के जो टॉपिक है, बड़ी खूबसूरत महिला हमारे इस मंच पर बैठी हुई है. पापा जी, बहुत बहुत स्वागत है आपका.
थैंक यू सोनाली, एंड आई वुड लाइक टू थैंक OCLF for giving me this honor to be here on this platform.
जी, Orange City Literature Fest festival का ये जो टॉपिक है वो है राइटिंग हिस्टोरिकल फिक्शन, टेलिंग आर हिस्ट्री थ्रू स्टोरीज. स्टोरीज का अपना एक इम्पैक्ट है हमारे जीवन में, बचपन से हम लोग सुनते आ रहे हैं. और खोका जो मिसेस बासु का एक बहुत ही पॉपुलर बुक है, इसके ऊपर हमने इस बुक से स्टार्ट करना है. और उससे पहले भी एक सवाल है मेरा कि मैम, ये जो खोका आपने लिखी है किताब, वो इसकी इंस्पिरेशन कहाँ से मिली? हाउ यू गेट इंस्पायर्ड टू राइट सच बुक?
ओके, सो खोका एक्चुअली इट इज अ कलेक्शन ऑफ शॉर्ट स्टोरीज जो मैंने बच्चों के लिए लिखी थी. दैट टाइम माय सन वाज वेरी स्मॉल एंड आई यूज्ड टू बी वेरी डिसअपॉइंटेड व्हेन आई यूज्ड टू सी हिम एंड हिज फ्रेंड्स जस्ट प्ले अराउंड विद यू नो foreign machine oriented toys, staying inside the house, you know, watching television, and then as they grew up, PlayStations and all that. So I used to be very upset, and I used to think, what can I do to, you know, pull them out of the house, to connect them with our own history, our own, you know, heritage, because they were so far removed from our legacy, from our heritage. And kya hota hai na, because the history that we are taught in school is so limited, you know, it's just about dates, it's just about a calendar, so and so king fought such and such battle and this empire and that dynasty. And the little stories, the stories of the common man, the time, you know, history is not just about dates. History is about our heritage, our common heritage, our treasured heritage, our treasured legacy.
True,
it is very, very important that we know about the milieu, the environment, you know, the flavor of that those times as well. वो हमको history historical characters से नहीं मिलने वाला है. वो हमको kings or queens से नहीं मिलने वाला है. You know, battles से नहीं मिलेगा. That's just the events. How will we? How can I tell my son this is the way people lived there? You know, 500 years ago, 1000 years ago, 200 years ago. This is not the way they lived. But they were also human beings like you and I. So when I was very small, I think I was in class 3 or 4. There's a lot of disturbance in the background. I think some probably mute your. Yes. Yeah, that's better. Yeah. So what happens is when my father was a great storyteller, like most of our fathers have been, our parents, our grandparents. So in class 3 or 4, I remember they used to tell us in school to write essays on what you did for your summer vacation this year, or you know, or a picnic or something, you went for a holiday. So once I was writing such an essay, and one of the things I wrote there was, you know, I went for a picnic and there was this mountain stream, and I tripped over the stones, the boulders in the stream, and the hills were in the background. And as I was writing, something happened in my heart, you know, wo kuch hua. So then I wrote, I carried on. And many, many years later, decades later, when I was seeing my son playing, you know, knowing more about other countries, their culture, their toys, their books, you know, their writers. So then all these stories that my father had told me came back to me. And I remembered that feeling that I had felt that time about crossing that mountain stream and the hills and the tiger coming. And then slowly I again asked him, I said, Dad, I remember those stories you told me over the dining table. You know, can you tell me those stories in detail again? So that's when he told me those stories again. And the descriptions were so, so vivid, which can only happen if you have experienced it yourself, you know. So he acquainted me. There is an echo. He acquainted me with places, with the times, with the you know, the people of those times, through his stories, which I could find nowhere in my history books. So that is when there are 6 stories in Khoka. The first story is about Khoka, and he lived in a joint family. Khoka is actually a term used for a mother uses for her son. It's an endearment, a term of endearment, a term of, like my dad himself said, you know, like he said, please explain the term, the name Khoka. So Khoka is symbolic of love, affection, expectation, and inspiration that all parents, you know, feel for their children. I mean, you know, they have these emotions for their children. So he used to grow up, he lost his father when he was 3, so he grew up with a host of cousins, lived in a new joint family, and it was a carnival. It was a complete, you know, riot each time, you know, these, all of them got together. And I asked him many years, in fact, just a few days before his death, I said, Dad, did you never miss your father? He said, no, I never miss my father, because, you know, I never got the chance to miss him, because there were so many uncles and aunts and cousins, and there was so much happening all the time. They never allowed me to miss my father. See, that is the difference. That is something that this generation, you know, has lost out on, because we live in nuclear families. We live in this small compartmentalized lives we lead. So they have lost touch with the bigger picture of life, with extended families, which was such a huge support system. And then he told me the second story was about this picnic the children go for. And this is based in Giridih, Hazaribagh, which is today's Jharkhand, which is very beautiful terrain, which has very beautiful terrain. And the mountain streams used to flood with one downpour of rain, you know. And so they went across, and there were the mahua trees and the sal trees, and there was a bear there. And there was a jackal, which was called fiao, you know, it used to move in front of a tiger. So the moment the jaguar would call out, they would know a tiger is in the vicinity. So they went there, and then there was a huge shower, and the river got flooded. And now they couldn't return. And then they heard the jaguar calling, and they knew a tiger was in there. So what happens then? Another story is on Subhash Chandra Bose and his fight for freedom when he leaves India after his disagreements with the International Congress. So he used to relay these speeches, you know, across from Vietnam, from Japan, from Germany. Once the Free India Radio came into, was opened up, and these transmissions used to happen. And these speeches were banned by the British in India. So in Koka's family, one day he and his cousins see, you know, suddenly something very suspicious happening. The adults have all had their meal quickly, and they are huddled into a room. So they're very curious. They want to know what is going on, but the children have not been included. And then he stumbles upon these speeches, give me your blood and I'll give you freedom. Netaji's voice, you know, booming in the middle of the night. And how he gets initiated into this freedom movement. That is his first initiation. And then he starts sitting when the discussions at home take place. You know, there are two distinctly different opinions. One, section of his family, some family members are supporting Gandhiji, the others are supporting Netaji, you know. And then he gets to know that Netaji was the name, the title Netaji was given to Subhash Chandra Bose by Mahatma Gandhi. And he was called the Mahatma, you know, by Netaji, father of the nation. And the term Jai Hind, how that was coined. You know, so that is Koka's initiation into the freedom struggle. And then through that story, the child of today would have got a glimpse into what was happening in the average Indian family that time. Unka kya, you know, response part was the freedom struggle. Everybody was not out on the streets slogan giving.
Absolutely.
Right. Everybody was not dying. Everybody was not blasting bombs. You know, they were the common people. So how was this freedom movement affecting the common people? Those stories we will not find in our history books.
So absolutely.
You know, so then there is a story when the children go for a cycle tour around Jharkhand, what is today the today's Jharkhand, the Chota Nagpur Plateau. So it gives a glimpse of the historic places around that region, like the Chinnaswamy Temple, the Rajarappa Falls, the Kodalma Mica mines. You know, Mica, how many people, if you read in our geography, that region was very rich in mica deposits. How many of us will remember that? Kisko yaad rahega? Kabhi padha hoga? But if your father tells you that as a story, you will remember it forever, right? If your father describes that he bathed in the icy waters of the Rajarappa Falls because he went and slept, you know, in the Chinnamastika Temple, in the courtyard of the Chinnamastika, you remember that. You start visualizing, and then you may want to go, you may want to find out more about that place. So that's what I'm saying. Then there is a story about Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose, how he comes and dies in Giridi. He actually came to get better there because Giridi was like a weekend, people used to come there to recuperate, to convalesce, you know, when they were getting better after an illness. So Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose came there. Then that story is about Sir Jagadish Chandra Bose, you know, his inventions for the wireless. It's a different perspective that we get to see through that story. And the last story is about the steamer ride across the River Padma from Calcutta from Gualandu to Dhaka, and it gets stuck in the River Padma. And this huge storm known as the Kaishalaki, how it's the steamer, which is run aground, which has got stuck for 36 hours. At that time, class distinctions between the British and the Indians, they are, you know, done away with because people are to survive, you know. So there, I brought forth the biases that people had, you know, Hindu, Muslims, British, natives, the discriminations that were taking place, how the people felt towards each other and what a calamity can do to bring them together, about the trade that took place on the River Padma. So my son wouldn't have got all this information from his history textbook. You know?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So that is the road of the book that Koka will take.
Okay.
I strongly urge that everyone should note down the family histories. because it's
a great takeaway, I can say, because you know, you should know your, you know, the leaders, history of the leaders, we are much aware of, right? But the history of the common people, how they were living their lives, you know, leading their lives, you know, what were the participation in the, you know, that time in the different events, historical events. So that's these are beautiful things. I just want to ask you, why history is such a boring subject in the classroom, and how can we make it more interesting?
This is the way. What is taught to us is about leaders and events and kings and queens. The end of it. It doesn't teach us the lessons we are supposed to learn from history. It doesn't tell us to alter or to be influenced by that history, because it is not telling us, maybe in one paragraph it will tell us what kind of a society it was, they wrote this, they did this. But until it is the story of the people of a nation, everything is about the people, the common man, people's story, your story, my story, you know, his story, her story. History is about stories, and these stories need to be told in order to be able to absorb the essence of our past. It's a collective past we all share. So it is imperative that we know not just about what kind of clothes they wore and what they ate, about the sentiments, the emotions of the people. It was a collective, like when I wrote about Ocha and Jhansi during the 1857 mutiny. You know, it is, that book is around a very small, insignificant, supposedly insignificant event, which was overshadowed by a larger event of 1857 mutiny. But it was only when I went to Ocha and when I spoke to the locals there, did I realize how that particular event had impacted the people, neighboring kingdoms, right, about which we've read nothing in our history books. So it is very important that history is made interesting by turning it into a story, and which is my purpose, which is the objective that I'm endeavoring to, you know, fulfill, that I tell about our past. It is absolutely necessary that we must know about our past. Know about your own past, before you know about the history and the heritage of
Well said. And I think this can create some interest in the history, and that will not be, you know, much boring subjects anymore.
And personally, in our country, you turn the corner and there's a story.
Yes.
I mean, I can't even begin to think how many stories can come out from our history, because India was a collective. A collection, literally, an assimilation of so many different kingdoms, many different languages, different cultures.
एक कहावत भी है आपने हर किसी को पता है, इंडिया में हर 20 मैलों पर पानी बदलता है और लोगों की रहने के तरीके बदलते हैं, खाना बदलता है, सब कुछ बदलता है, तो कितनी कहानियां होगी आप इतना ये करते हैं, और हर चीज का कितना हिस्टोरिकल इन्फ्लुएंस होगा हर तरीकों पर जीने के. मैं ओरछा पर जरूर जाना चाहूंगी. ओरछा की कहानी आपसे कैसे लिखी और क्या है वो किताब में, वो बिल्कुल जानना चाहेंगे हम. लेकिन उससे पहले एक सवाल आता है, जब भी हिस्टोरिकल फिक्शन राइटर की बात आती है, वी ऑलवेज थिंक अबाउट दैट कि हिस्टोरिकल राइटर्स जनरली फैक्ट्स एंड फिगर्स के साथ में एक क्रिएटिव लिबर्टी लेते हैं क्या, ये सवाल अक्सर रहता है. व्हाट विल बी योर आंसर?
इनफैक्ट यस्टरडे वी वर हैविंग दिस डिस्कशन इन द ड्यूरिंग द पैनल डिस्कशन दैट वी हैड. There is always a kind of a very subtle war going on between historical fiction writers and historical narrative non-fiction writers. So we are not talking about the academics here. Okay, we are talking about
fiction stories.
Fiction writers.
Yeah.
We can take liberty. We can take a little bit of license when we are dealing with the characters, the characterization, with the plot. You know. But we cannot mess around with the dates, with the events. I cannot say 1857. I cannot say the mutiny, Sepoy mutiny happened in 1860. No. No matter what the story contains, I can't change the facts. I can't change the event, because it is around that event that my story has been, you know, created, has been formed. So you can't say, okay, Actually, Rani of Jhansi was not the ruler of this thing. And I suddenly produce a kid of hers, a child of hers, actually Hiru. No. I can't. The facts. Sick facts have to remain as they are. But I can add, there will be add-ons, value additions. You know, like I can add, introduce new characters who can enhance the story and take it forward. I can introduce new plots. But the historical events, right. I can't take the devices. And if you're writing historical narrative non-fiction, then you cannot even mess with the characters, because then it doesn't become a story. It's no longer a story. Here I'm writing a story, but I can't change the facts. I can't change the date of a battle. I can't change the ruler.
Only writer have the imaginative liberty, creative liberty with the characters, with the plot, right? But cannot mess up with the events and all. Right, we are coming to the
There is a short passage in my book which Rani Lakshmibai is shown standing before the mirror wearing this very absolutely very exquisite and very, very expensive necklace that her husband is supposed to have gifted her on the birth, on her marriage, because she was years younger to her husband. Now, I don't know if she was wearing that necklace or not, right? It was a necklace which had suddenly become very popular in the West, in Europe. It was very exquisite and very rare. And her husband had, what I have written in the story, is her husband, King of Jhansi. He spent a good amount of his, you know, resources to get that, buy that and have it shipped across to India to gift his very young wife. So now, I don't know whether Lakshmibai actually had that necklace or not. That I added to her character. But I can't change that she's not married to Gangadhar Rao, or, you know, she was not the Queen of Jhansi. You see what I mean? I can introduce certain aspects of her, or heighten certain personality traits of her. Like, she was a very good diplomat. Now, very few of us know that Rani of Jhansi, the Queen of Jhansi, Rani Lakshmibai, was a fantastic diplomat. And that's where she really broke ground, because she fought with the British at that level, which was really unexpected. In those days, 150 years ago, women, not even if women were sitting on the throne, there were very few women who could, engage in very important diplomatic discussions, have a continuous exchange of letters which were very precise, very logical, and very well articulated. Very few. She was very well read. She was lettered. The British were not expecting that from her.
Right.
But what image do we have of her? What image do we have of her? Sitting on a horse and holding a sword. That is one aspect of her. So I wanted to focus on that she was a very good, she could have made a very good lawyer. You know? So these things we can...
So definitely you have taken all the liberty to glorify her persona, which was already there, but you wanted to just glorify it, right? Yeah.
So these things we can find in the history of
the world. Yeah, right. So now, because you shared me, off the camera, the beautiful story about how you started these things, and Orcha, when you visited Orcha, how beautifully the story and the book came out, right? So will you please share the story, and will you please share the story of the Queen's last salute? How it came?
Okay, I have been very fortunate. Because I have lived in places that have been historically very significant in our national's history. Okay, our national history, they are landmark places. For instance, I was born and brought up in Delhi. Delhi is historically very rich. Then I have lived in Meerut, from where essentially the mutiny started, from the Kali Pantan Mandir there. Then I've lived in Jhansi. And I've lived in Hyderabad, and now I live in Pune. So I've been very fortunate. I think I'm very blessed that, I've lived in places which are so steeped in our history. So anyway, my husband was in the army, so he was posted in Jhansi. And just on a sightseeing tour, we went to Orcha, which is about 20 kilometers from Jhansi. And I didn't know about Orcha ever before that. Okay, I'd not read about Orcha, leave alone Orcha's role in Jhansi, the role that Orcha, its neighboring kingdom, played in the political map of Jhansi. I had no clue. So when I went there and I looked at the forts and fortresses, at the temples and the geography of the place and the beautiful river Betwa, I was absolutely stumped. I was awestruck, you know. And I was wondering, I said, why? And then I learned, and I spoke to the locals there, and they told me that this used to be the capital of the Bundelas. For a good 300 years, this was the capital of Bundelkhand. The famous Bundela rulers ruled this region. How much do we know about it through our history books? I was absolutely amazed. And I had not even heard of Ocha, despite having studied history well into my college years. So I said, this place needs, I mean, it was so, such a glorious kingdom, you know, such a glorious kingdom, and we know nothing about it other than that we've been taught over and over again. So then I started researching about Orcha. I started speaking to the people of Orcha. And in fact, I stumbled upon this man who had lived in Orcha. I mean, whose family had been living there for three generations. So then he took me to those places in Orcha, which normally a tourist guide will not take you. Now Orcha figures in the tourism map of international tourism circuit, you know. But this was many years ago, almost 18 years ago. Nobody heard of Orcha, and it now features in Lonely Planet as well. And that time, they all think, okay, this is the fort, this is the fortress, this is the Chaturbhuj temple, this is the Ram Raja temple. This is the only place in the country where Raja, where Ram is worshipped as a king. Okay, and it is a beautiful legend attached to it. And because of that, the capital had to shift, as per legend, had to shift to Tikamgarh from Orcha. So Orcha palace was abandoned because there was a condition that Lord Ram imposed that, you know, other than me, there could be nobody else ruling Orcha at the same time, which is why the people believe that, you know, the capital shifted to Tikamgarh. Now, this is such a beautiful story, the folklore, what we know, which we hear from our bards, from minstrels. They go around the country singing, telling us the bowels of Bengal, for instance. That's, of course, more devotional. But our folk songs is what? About the people, about the traditions, about the culture of that particular region. That's what folk tales are all about. So you can get many stories, and you can capture the spirit of a region, from folk tales. So I lay a lot of emphasis on folk tales, on folklore, and I get a lot of my information from there. So that's how Orcha happened. And when I researched further, I realized Orcha had played a very important role in Jhansi's history. Jhansi was a part of Orcha, you know, which for political reasons was taken away. And Jhansi was in fact created to protect Orcha. So all this we don't read. And it is such a, it used to be an erstwhile kingdom, but such a glorious kingdom. We don't get to read. So I felt it was necessary. I talk about this beautiful place and, present its art and architecture and folk tales and, even the terrain, the place, incidentally, for me at least, the place, the geography of a place also works while writing a book. I find that very important because geography plays a very important inhabitation in civilization. So most of the civilizations, as all of us know, have been along rivers, you know, and India is full of rivers. So, you know, until you really describe the place well, the terrain of the place, which plays a big role in the history of that region, not really written your story well. So, you know, part of lots of this Queen's Last Salute has a lot to do with the terrain of that place. In fact, the climaxes, you know, because of the terrain. I mean, whatever happens partly, and in fact, largely because of the terrain, the geography of that region. It's rocky, it's barren, you know, it's very hot. So geography for me, the landscape is physical. Physical descriptions are very important. I have to feel, and I have to stand on the soil of that place to really absorb, feel the spirit of that place, that their people, you know. So everything plays a very important role.
It's again a fiction, right? It's again a fiction.
Queen's Last Salute is fiction. All my three books are so far historical fiction, but my next book will not be fiction.
So how that fiction came, can you please tell us our viewers that, you know, if they want to read the book, that means how the fiction, you know, came across, what are the stories, which stories they can, because it's geographical and things you have already told.
Actually,
right?
Important book is a completely original story. Yeah, it is a completely original story. I really can't express how I created the story. It just happened. Like, you know, I kept revising. I came back to Pune. And years after I had been to Ocha, I started visualizing this girl going across to Ocha, and the story just happened. And there is no hard and fast rule how you create a story. It is a combination of many factors, many influences, you know, that form that story in your head. So it didn't happen overnight.
Right, but it's the Anarkali and the Salim, a retelling of Mughal-e-Azam, right? That is the next book, and it really, it's amazing, you know, what the plot you used, and it, because, you know, traditionally, one conventional story we are listening or we are watching from long, long years, right? Everybody has the impression that the Salim was like that, Anarkali was like that, Akbar, but you entirely differ from all this stuff. Which was, you know, we are conventionally, we are listening from long, long years, right? From generation to generations, rather, I will say. So, how it came and what are the research and how did you find it? Because multiple questions I have within one question.
See, the film Anarkali, full film Mughal-e-Azam was celebrating its Grand Jubilee this year. So, we thought that, you know, it would be a good idea to revisit the story. And of course, there have been other screen adaptations of the story earlier. But if I had to write a book on the story of Mughal-e-Azam, then what was new that I was offering to my readers? Everybody knows the story. The Purana Ghisa Peta storyline, plot, everybody knows it. Okay, so what am I offering to my readers? I want to pick up a book on Mughal-e-Azam. So that was when I decided to find out the genesis of the story. When was the first time the story was thought of? You know, the first time they thought of making a movie? And was there any truth in Anarkali's existence? That is also very, you know, doubtful. A lot of debate has ensued for years, for centuries, whether Anarkali existed or not. Uthi or Nahi? We don't know. And who was she? So then I started researching, and I was pleasantly surprised to find out that Anarkali love story was for the first time written by a man called Taj Imtiaz Ali, who was a resident of Lahore in the year 1900 and I think 2 or 3. Okay, and like I said this yesterday also, he was very much influenced by the modern prose genre in the West, around historical tragic tales, you know, where you know, like Romeo and Juliet, where the lovers can't meet because of family hurdles or whatever. So, and we ourselves heard legends of Leela and Majnu. In fact, Jahangir himself in his book Jahangir Nama has mentioned he was seeing a pair of Saras cranes, okay, mating, and he named them Leela and Majnu. Okay, so Jahangir himself has mentioned. So we know of all these stories, but Anarkali came from where? So then I found out that Taj Imtiaz Ali, who was living in Lahore, had heard the story of Salim and Anarkali forever, since he was a child. So in his neighborhood, as he was growing up, he grew up with the story of Anarkali and Salim. So iska koi to base hoga. There must be some genesis somewhere, something. Why suddenly was the story created? Because there is no mention of Anarkali in any of the official chronicles of the Mughal dynasty. Yet there is a tomb in Lahore where there is an inscription on a sarcophagus that, you know, if only I could behold your face until the last day of my resurrection, or something to that effect, signed Salim, son of Akbar. There has been huge debate over this. Who has written this? Is it a... Now, one Salim Majnu, Akbar. So Salim Majnu, son of Akbar. So one historian says that no Mughal emperor would call himself Majnu. Some other historian says that this is one of Salim's wives, Jahangir's wives. So then another historian counters that by saying no man would want to wish to see his wife's face. Hasn't he seen it enough? You know? Then one historian says, no, this was one of Akbar's wives. But the foreign travelers at that time had mentioned Anarkali, pomegranate kernel. You know? Anarkali, but which was the name Akbar is supposed to have given to her. So these, there are many theories which abound, you know, many, unofficial mention of her in travelogues. Thereafter, if Salim, Taj Imtiaz Ali has heard about this story, then obviously the story has been generating for many centuries around Lahore. And then the tomb is there. Whose tomb is that? So I absorbed all that, and I found it very fascinating that the writer, the playwright, adapted it as a historical tragic tale, which went down very well with the British, because the British were trying to portray an image of, you know, being, you know, like they are civilizing us. We are such a brutal lord, brutal country where emperors kill, put a woman who is alive into a tomb and bury her alive. And but the people were not very happy with the portrayal of Akbar like that. And then we know that, you know, Mughalism, the ending was changed. So I wanted to, I asked myself, I said, what new, what is it, what, dif- how, what new thing can I offer to my different times when I thought of making an Anatolian Persian. And the political condition of Persia and the exchanges between Persia and India were such those days that it was quite possible that she could have fled her war-torn country. Persia was in the thick of war.
Yeah, but I think you have a story also related to that, that you were sharing between Maryam, that story, Salim's mother, who was a very good businesswoman also that time.
Maryam Zamani used to be a very good businesswoman. She had her own fleet of ships.
Yeah. Right.
Trading, you know.
So that reference you received, right? While changing on the plot.
Zamani had her own fleet of ships. Yeah, so I decided to make a Persian who comes initially as an opportunist because she has to survive. She's lost everybody, her family, everything, her country. She's fled her country. So she comes to the great Mughal kingdom, you know, the capital of which is in Lahore at that time. And Emperor Akbar, who is the Mughal-e-Azam, the Shahinshah of Shahinshahs, is sitting on the throne there. And she thinks she plays a musical. I've made her a musician rather than a dancer, you know. So she plays this musical instrument, and she thinks she can, you know, find a place in Akbar's harem or Akbar's court where she can play music. And initially, the lens she goes to please Akbar. You know, I won't give away the story. It's the story is actually an e-book. The book has come out as an e-book. But the initially, Akali, you know, goes to any lens to please Akbar to gain favor. She lies and enters the court of Akbar. And then once she falls in love with Salim, how she changes. So what I've done in this story is, I have, instead of focusing on the plot and the storyline, which all of us are aware of, there is nothing new I can offer there, I have focused on characters, on the development of the characters. And the story is narrated from the point of view of three characters. So every chapter is a different narrator. So here, first, you will see Anarkali narrating part of the story. Next chapter is Salim, and he takes off from where Anarkali is left off. Third chapter is Akbar. So we get an insight into the minds of each character, the three characters of the book. I feel that since I can't offer, like in Queen's Last Salute, the most important thing is what next? Ab kya hone wala hai? How will the book end? No, that factor is not there in Mughal-e-Azam, right? We all know kya hone wala hai. So why not focus on the characters? Because how many of us have really, when you watch the film, we saw the sizzling chemistry of Dilip Kumar and Madhubala, all right, or even Pradeep Kumar and Beena Rai and all the stage You know, there was a movie in Pakistan too by Noor Jahan, the famous singer, beautiful singer who played the role of an architect. But how many of them actually delved into the minds of these three characters? What was going on in Anarkali's mind? It is not, I mean, can you even imagine the two being encased within a brick tomb, you know, a tomb, and you're going to die? So what were the last moments like? What was she feeling? No movie, no director has portrayed that. They've just shown Anarkali, you know, being buried alive, and then Saleem coming and crying on her grave. But what was she going through? What was Akbar going through when he passed that verdict, you know, when he ordered for her to be killed? What was going on in his mind? You know, so it is very, and the development of Anarkali's character from being an opportunist to a woman who gives her life for the sake of love. So what does her evolution be, you know, as a character? So these are the things I have changed in the book. And since there was no definite knowledge of who Anarkali was, what was the source, you know, where she came from, we don't know. So I took a liberty, a little bit of liberty, creative liberty there to make her a Persian, keeping in mind the political situation that I can't change. I can't change the political map of Persia or India or the relations between India and Persia. I can use that to my advantage and weave it into my plot. So this is how it works.
So now, Arikal, this is true, means beautiful, actually. I just, you know, wanted to, you know, keep listening, because the beautiful things. One thing, because I just want to, because you, being a writer, you always study the psyche of the society, psyche of the that era also, right?
Since,
mind ke andar jana, you know, you're a spy that way. So, who inspired you a lot in your life as a writer? Who is the other writer you always admire?
I love many writers, so I wouldn't pinpoint any one particular author or writer. But I enjoy books. I enjoy reading those books which focus on two things. One is human emotion, and one is landscape, places. These are the two things.
Okay.
Any writer, any author who talks of these two things, going into, you know, exploring the workings of a human being's mind, or bringing forth the emotions of that of his characters. This is very important to me because I connect with that. You know. Second is, you know, the geographical setting about the place. You know, I love to read books which are about places, about everything of that place, the geography of that place, the culture of that place. So these two, any book which sort of, you know, adheres to these two particular aspects, I like reading such books. But there is no such, I would say places inspire me. Places. So if I go to a place, up till now, the books I've written are all because of the places, of course, Phuka stories, and that also because I think I was interested because he was explaining in detail about those places. So it is like in my mind, my father used to say a wonderful thing. Dad, I want to go there, and he used to say, "Chiya, tomorrow. What do you mean tomorrow? What, you would describe place so well?" I said, "Have you been there?" He said, "No." I said, "No. What looks for?"
Oh, lovely.
You don't have to go to a place to know about that place. You know, you can know about any place through books. So this is something I want
to... Right, this is the beauty of the books, actually. It can take you to any place, yeah? Imagination can take you to any place. So that's the beauty. Which are the characters you are feeling for the future books? Like, you know, these are the character fascinates me a lot, that I will definitely go and, you know, some the places, and I will write it on.
As of now, historical characters So the next book is again about a historical love story. It is also about a historical love story, controversial historical love story. So I love the past. Let's put it this way. I love the past because, and especially our past, our collective past, because it's so interesting. It's so rich, you know. So I will say historical characters continue to fascinate me. Our heroes and heroines from the past, our common men, common women, you know.
So you always like, because I have, you know, seen you a couple of interviews also. So the heroism in the women, you always praise for, right? You take the to most of the character you have taken from the history, like, you know. So common man ke andar ka jo heroism hai, wo bada aapko bada bhata hai, wo samajh mein aata hai.
Yes, because again, when we talk of heroes and heroines, it's those fixed leaders, right? But every person has a hero and a heroine within him or her. This is what, and what, and our freedom struggle, for instance, both 1857 mutiny and thereafter, was entirely won by just leaders and warriors. You know, the kings and queens, it was won by the common men. Revolt of 1857 is largely a common man's revolution, common man's mutiny. And this has happened in countries and histories all across the world. It is only when there's an uprising of the people that governments turn around, you know, topple. So it was, there is a leader in every human being. So I wanted to bring out one such, you know, how do we know that our freedom struggle was not, that there's been so much contribution by those who have some, who have not been talked about, the common men, the common women. So my heroine of this last salute is one such woman who, she could have been anybody. She could have been any, you know, important female character from history. So she is that, you know, archetype of that insurgent minority of women who have fought for their beliefs, for their convictions, for their country, for the nation, but remain unsung till today. So history is again not just about the leaders and the heroes and heroines, the kings and queens and emperors. The underdogs. True.
Very true. लेकिन being writer, because filmmaker के और writers के नसीब में बहुत बार controversies भी आती हैं, right? So कभी ऐसी creative liberty लेने के बाद में या fiction होने के बाद में ऐसे कभी controversies को भी आपको face करना पड़ा, या फिर उसके controversies के को मद्देनजर रखते हुए भी आपने कुछ plots को change किया? Has it happened anyways?
So far it hasn't. I don't know in the future, but yes, again, like, India is a very volatile country. It's a, you know, people are very sensitive about a lot of issues, a lot of things. So my objective, my purpose is to bring forth the past. Okay. And just unnecessarily getting involved in controversy, unnecessarily, you know, talking about something which may evoke, you know, certain passions. I wouldn't want to get into that. So if there are aspects of a certain figure, a well-known historical figure, because you know, there are all kinds of people who have written all kinds of stuff about our leaders, about our heroes and heroes. And it's been happening for centuries. If it is not really required in my plot, you know, if I can sort of go around it, I don't necessarily, you know, bring that. Everything doesn't create a nice story without explain and describe a personality without word. Somebody is I think you'll have to go on mute. You can describe a personality without bringing controversy into it. Everything doesn't need to be controversial, right?
Right. हम लोग अभी शायद समय समाप्ति के और बढ़ रहे हैं, हमारे पास बहुत ही कम समय है, समर शायद अग्री करेंगे इससे, और लेकिन अब जाते जाते बहुत सारे सवाल और भी हैं मन में, क्योंकि बिकॉज यू नो हिस्ट्री ऐसे सब्जेक्ट है जब उसके भी फिक्शन आ जाता है, कहानी आते हैं तो बहुत इंटरेस्टिंग होती है चीज़ें, लेकिन जैसे हमने पहले भी बात करी थी मतलब स्टार्टिंग में कि हिस्ट्री जो है क्लासरूम्स में इंटरेस्टिंग होनी चाहिए, आपको क्या लगता है कि किस तरह से इसे अगर स्ट्रेटेजिकली हम बात करें तो किस तरह से हम ये हिस्ट्री को और इंटरेस्टिंग बना सकते हैं? स्टोरीज तो फॉर्मेट आएगा ही, लेकिन वो टेक्स्ट बुक्स में कैसे आए?
Well, I don't prepare the syllabus, so I'm really not a man educationist, so I won't be able to, I'm not equipped to talk about that. But what I can perhaps say is that syllabus may, you can only talk this much and not more. But also, a little more space can be given to talk about the milieu, the environment, the atmosphere, and about the common man, maybe. But the teacher who is teaching, can be a little bit more interesting, you know. May tell that particular event in a more interesting manner, you know, right. To get a captive audience. If you're just sometimes our teachers are also, you know, they're as bored as the students. They're just rattling off the dates and the, you know, the events. But if they can perhaps, you know, engage their students through, you know, the stories, adding a story there. I really don't know, Sonali. This is not my area, my realm.
Right, but you know, you have really took us. Honestly, you have taken us to the another world, actually, in the history, actually, and you love the past, and we really mesmerized with your talk. Thank you so very much for taking us back in the history and, you know, taking us to on this journey. It's beautiful. It's amazing. In fact, abhi aur fir se ek daur aana shuru ho jayega, jahan par kahaniyon ka daur hoga, historical kahaniyon ka daur hoga, fir se ek nayi नई नई कहानियां हम लोग सुनेंगे और वो कहानियां हमारे जहन में पूरे कई दिनों तक कई सालों तक चलेगी. थैंक यू सो वेरी मच, आपने समय दिया आपका और हमें इस जर्नी पर लेकर गए. बहुत बहुत शुभकामनाओं के साथ धन्यवाद.
थैंक यू सोनाली, एंड आई विल रिक्वेस्ट एवरीवन टू मेंटेन देयर फैमिली डायरीज.
या
दैट्स वेयर द स्टोरीज आर, दैट्स वेयर द रियल स्टोरीज आर.
या
थैंक यू वेरी मच.
थैंक यू सो मच. Yeah, over to you, Samarth.
Thank you so much, Mopia and Sonali ma'am, for this marvelous conversation. I'm sure the audience is delighted to witness all of this. I also thank the publisher Juggernaut for all the help, and a big thank you to SGR Knowledge Foundation for conducting this event. On behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Lastly, I'd like to thank the audience for being with us. Hope everyone has a great day ahead. Thank you.
Thank you.
20 years of existence. 2 universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions, a vision beyond.